Hello and welcome to our roundtable discussion on school closures and the COVID-19 pandemic. I'm Jennifer Nuzzo and I'm very pleased to be presiding over this conversation. Pandemic-related school closures have affected more than 50 million K-12 students in the United States. By the end of March 2020, every school district but one closed in response to COVID-19, and many of these school districts stayed closed well into 2021. And we're starting to amass data that show that these closures resulted in profound learning loss. The emerging data raise deep concerns that we will need serious interventions to recover from the pandemic-related learning losses in the US and abroad. In his COVID-19 plan released this month, President Biden identified efforts to prevent economic and educational shutdowns as one of four key goals for the nation as it moves forward for the pandemic. The administration also noted that it has to date provided states via the American Rescue Plan $130 billion to reopen schools by improving ventilation, increasing access to testing, hiring more teachers, nurses, and other staff. But beyond this, we need more data to know if these resources are enough and whether they're achieving the stated goals. We also need to know more fully the magnitude and nature of pandemic-related learning losses to understand if we're on the right path to educational recovery or whether we need larger, bolder national efforts to bring children back to where they need to be. So to help us better understand what we currently know about pandemic-related school closures and learning loss, we're fortunate to be joined today by someone who has been actively trying to address existing data gaps and who has been living in these data to understand what the impacts of the pandemic have been on children. Emily Oster is a professor of economics at Brown University and the author of several New York Times bestselling books on evidence-based approaches to parenthood, Expecting Better, Crib Sheet, and The Family Firm. And throughout the pandemic, Dr. Oster has been working to amass data pertaining to school closures and their impacts. Unfortunately, official efforts to track data on the impacts of school closures and reopenings have been sparse. The lack of a national system to track pandemic-related impacts on schools has really limited decision-making about how best to keep schools open and recover from the impacts of school closures. So seeing these gaps, Dr. Oster launched a bold initiative to amass the data needed to make decisions about schools. Her COVID-19 School Data Hub is a central database of how the pandemic shaped US students' mode of learning in the last few years. And with data from more than 50,000 schools across 31 states, maybe she can update us on the numbers. It's really one of the most comprehensive efforts yet to document how schools operated during the pandemic. And I'm sure will better enable us to measure the impact of these closures on children's education. But I will let Emily tell us more about the Data Hub and what she's learned so far. She's agreed to give some opening remarks and then we'll turn to questions. So please, Emily, take it away.
All right. Thank you, Jennifer. And thank you, everybody, for being here. So I'm just going to show you a few slides because some of the stuff I think is better illustrated. Jennifer, can you see these slides? Is better illustrated with some pictures, and then hopefully we can have some discussion. So just to sort of like, I think this, in some sense, this is something most of us know, but just to sort of set the stage, if you kind of think about the broad scope of what happened over the last, you know, several years, in March 2020, basically everybody closed their schools except for Sweden. And that was true with the US and internationally. There was some reopening of schools in Europe and the UK kind of in the sort of late spring, summer of 2020 because of their school calendar. And then when we moved in the US to sort of August and September, this kind of initially some reopenings, particularly in the South, where the school calendar is a bit comes a bit earlier. And then in the fall, some places were open, some places were not. And that kind of like ebbed and flowed through the fall. And then there was sort of generally some more reopening, particularly post the new administration in the winter and spring. And during this school year, most places have been open fairly consistently for in-person learning. I got interested in this or like passionate about this, concerned about this, whatever it is, you know, quite early on, as I think many of us did. And this is a graph that we had in like May of 2020. It's not, you know, super important where this comes from. This comes from an online learning platform called Zurn. But what was helpful about this learning platform was because schools were using it on computers both before and then during the kind of spring 2020 closures, it provided kind of a real-time way to track the learning losses that we were seeing in that initial shutdown period. And what we saw, you can sort of see in the graph here, is the vertical axis is a metric of how much of this learning students are completing. And you can see that that goes down sort of immediately in March, sort of mid-March 2020, when everything shuts down. And it doesn't really rebound, particularly in the kind of lower and middle income school districts. So this is kind of, I think, a first clue of potentially quite large drops. I mean, again, sort of if you look at this, it's like a 50% drop in how much kids are doing. That's a pretty big drop, and that drop is larger in more disadvantaged districts. And that's something we'll see sort of again and again and again. So I want to tell you a little bit about kind of what we did over the last year, first to construct data, and then second to look in a more holistic way at the impacts of learning mode on test scores, particularly focused on the 2020-2021 school year, the kind of where there was a fair amount of variation, how disrupted it was. So in terms of the data, I think Jennifer alluded to this a little bit, but one of the things that has been sort of a hallmark of this space over the last couple of years is that the official data collection, certainly at the federal level, about what was going on in schools was quite lacking. And so initially, we saw that lack really in tracking of COVID cases in schools. And so I did some work on that early in the pandemic. But as we moved to sort of later in the pandemic, it also became clear that our understanding of what had happened in terms of what kind of school students had access to, that information was also effectively missing. And the kind of best data that we had, it certainly that was kind of shared publicly through the last school year, was from effectively like private sector individuals like Dennis Roche at Burbio, who was kind of putting together these data more or less on their own. So at the end of the last school year, kind of reflecting on that and thinking about it as an academic, I came to think, as I think many people did, that it would be very valuable if we could have some information on schooling that was more systematic. So what we did is very simple in some ways and very annoying in other ways. So we wrote to the state education agencies throughout the country. We tried to get basically any information states had about the opening modes of their schools. This included what modes they were in, how many kids were in different modes, when they made changes, and so on. A substantial amount of the data ended up coming out of a program called the Pandemic EBT program. That program is one that actually gave students, that was a program that was designed to give students resources if their school was closed because they didn't get free lunch. And it turned out, as a result of that program, many districts could keep this records, even though it was sort of through this other program. So we got a bunch of data out of that, and we created this basically public data resource, which for many states is at the school month level or the school week level. We have like quite granular data. So we built this public resource, which you can get onto and download, and I can put the website in the chat. But if we kind of look at the overall sort of picture here, so this is what this looks like in October. This is just a map. This is a map of the U.S. in terms of the, like, where we've labeled with blue the places that are in person, with yellow the places that were hybrid, and the red the places that were virtual. This is what it looks like in October. You can see the kind of like redness in the blue states. As we said, it's red in the blue states and blue in the red states. And that's a sort of consistent feature of the entire school year. So this is October. We move to November, kind of more stuff sort of closes a little bit. In January, it's kind of, I would say, the nadir. And then we get to March and things start opening more. And if you sort of scroll around the website, you can sort of play around a little bit with it. what you can see from this is that our data coverage is better in some locations than others. So Jennifer sort of talked about how many, I don't actually know how many states we're at this point. It's a reasonable number. We're missing some that are very physically large, like Montana, which I'm keep hoping to fill in because it's so big. But in, you know, in general, I think the data on this has sort of proved to be quite, you know, quite comprehensive, and I'm hoping it will prove to be quite useful. And just as sort of a first, like kind of tenor of that, let me show you what we're seeing in terms of test scores. So there's sort of wide variation in in-person learning access, as we saw, and then there has been a fair amount of speculation about the impacts of that remote schooling on the US, but relatively little systematic data. So what we did was we merged in test score data from the states that had put, that had done test score testing, sort of statewide testing in spring of 2021. And then we merged it with our in-person schooling data, kind of look at what went on. And so I just want to show you sort of two pictures. So this is a kind of table of what happens overall. And I'd say like the biggest takeaway is that there's an enormous decline in the share of students passing. And that is actually uniform across all of these states. So even a place like Wyoming, where about 90% of kids had access to full-time in-person schooling over the pandemic, there's still about a 4 percentage point drop in pass rates in math, but 2 percentage points drops in ELA. So that's, you know, that's actually a pretty substantial year-on-year change. But if we look at a place like Virginia, where 9% of the students, sort of the access to in-person schooling was about 9% instead of 90%, the declines are 32 percentage points in math and 9 percentage points in ELA. So across states and actually even across districts within states and even across districts in the same commuting zone, which have different learning modes, we see substantial evidence that remote learning was linked with worse learning, worse test score outcomes for students. So if we compare basically two districts which are in the same commuting zone, so these would be places like, I live in Rhode Island, so it'd be like Providence and Pawtucket, places which share almost everything about their pandemic experience, their labor market, everything else, but Providence was in person and Pawtucket was not. The data predicts about an 8 percentage point difference in the resulting pass rates in those two districts. So that's kind of the big, one of the sort of big overarching takeaways from this. Overall, huge decline and a decline that is substantially larger for districts that were remote. The other thing that is really important to note here is the intersection of this with demographics. So let me put this up and then I'll sort of stop and Jennifer and I can talk about it a little bit. There are kind of two ways in which students of color and students who are lower income suffered more as a result of this. One is that those are the groups who are least likely to have had access to in-person school. So when we look at the determinants of in-person schooling, because of both the political bent and other features, Black and Hispanic students, Black students in particular, much less likely to have access to in-person schooling. In addition, what this picture shows is that the benefits to in-person schooling are larger for that group. Or conversely, the risks to not having in-person schooling, the risks to virtual schooling, the downsides to virtual schooling were largest for these groups. So Black students were both less likely to have access to in-person schooling and more likely to suffer from not having that access in a sort of like compounding negative impact. So you know, we take away from this, I think, that this problem is very significant. This problem is very significant over the last year, and that we are really going to need to work on recovery. And I'm not sure exactly what the paths into that are, but I think that that's kind of a very key element of what we're going to need to do over the next year, 5 years, decade, potentially quite a long time. So let me stop there. I'm happy to then talk about what we are seeing.
Yeah. Wow. Thank you. Thanks for that. Really, and appreciate it. It is important to see the graphs. I appreciate your bringing them. So I think we're going to turn to questions. What I do is encourage everyone who's listening who wants to ask a question to start raising your hands and sort of get in the queue. But while everyone's doing that, I will start the conversation. Get the conversation going. So one of the things I want to ask you is you referenced sort of your earlier work, earlier in the pandemic, where you noted the kind of absence of data about COVID cases in schools. And for anyone who has following the issue closely, could you just talk a little bit about what the data environment was, what you did, and just what you think the impacts of that were?
Sure. So that work, I think we really started thinking about and kind of and maybe July of 2020, because that was a point at which there was actually quite a lot of uncertainty about how risky it was going to be, I think, to open schools. So there was kind of some encouraging evidence from the UK, but the US quite different from the UK. I sort of recall noticing that there were districts opening in Georgia and Indiana and, some of these kind of early places, which at the time were having their first kind of summer surge and saying, okay, well, at least, when these districts open, we're going to learn whether schools are high risk or not, because basically these districts are opening, they're opening with almost no precautions. So when we see, how many COVID cases there are in schools, we'll be able to figure out, what is going to happen. And the reality is that at that time, there was basically no effort to collect that kind of information. There was nobody who was planning to track the combination of stuff that you needed, which was information on how many kids were in school and how many COVID cases there were. And I remember there was this, I think a low moment for me was there was a New York Times had a kind of case tracker, where they were counting cases in schools. And it was a little footnote at the bottom that said, not all schools were in session when these cases were collected. And it was sort of it was anybody who reported in a case for someone who was affiliated with a school got counted as a school case. And that felt like, okay, that's a pretty data poor environment if you're relying on kind of self-reports among people who are affiliated with schools. And so we sort of started this really grassrootsy type of approach of kind of reaching out to districts, reaching out to schools, ultimately pulling in some data from states and kind of organizing it in a systematic way, and then tracking over time, how many kids were in school, how many teachers were in school, and then how many cases you were seeing in schools. So what we saw early on was what I think has sort of proved to be true, even in substantially better data, which was that there was not a lot of spread in schools, that in fact schools did not prove to be the sort of super spreaders that some people feared. And that was something we saw in our data, relatively early on, kind of in the sort of October, November time. I think ultimately when we got to, January, February, there was kind of more general agreement about that point based on a bunch of data, including ours.
I guess one of the things that we've really fretted about throughout this pandemic is just the quality of the data. And I'd always hope that, it's not just about was there a case reported in a kid who went to school? I mean, ideally we would have had sort of contract tracing data to tell us, was it likely that the cases resulted from in a school exposure? I would say the overall level of data that's been available to help us understand where people are getting COVID have been poor, but have you come across any places that did a particularly good job? Did you ever see these data?
Yeah. So the best data that sort of, there's the kind of two sources of, I think, quite good data on that question. So one is the ABC collaborative data from North Carolina. So basically these guys in North Carolina tracked, I think it was 90,000 students and staff in a bunch of schools over a pretty long period of, they may have gone for the whole year, but I think they reported out kind of mid-year last year. And they were tracking who brings COVID to school and then who spreads it in school, which is exactly, I think, the thing that you want. Part of the frustration and the thing that was hard on our data side was okay, what we're collect, what the easiest thing to collect is how many people associated with the school have COVID. That's actually, it doesn't tell you that they got it at school, right? It just tells you that they have COVID. So these guys in North Carolina did this sort of careful contact tracing. And what they saw sort of in this, like the fall of 2021, the fall of 2020, I think, was like there were 773 cases that sort of showed up at school, and there were 32 secondary infections. So that was like quite a low rate. The second piece of data that was, I think, very encouraging there was from New York, where they collected information on conversions among kids who were quarantined. So they were doing a lot of quarantining, and then they would like track how many people got it in quarantine. And the answer was like they quarantined. I mean, that was an incredibly low number. It was like they quarantined 13,000 kids or something for in school exposure. And there were like 62 cases or something, you know, so those numbers were also very small. But I think those were the two things that came out eventually that sort of pointed to me like, okay, you know, now we're seeing even these better data, again, this sort of close evidence of like very low in school spread.
So you're in conversations about the data tracking efforts in schools. And do you sense that there is like a movement to try to improve our data collection efforts? I mean, mindful one, that the pandemic's not over, but two, we're gonna go into another school year that not only will have COVID, but also flu and other things. And before this pandemic, flu did occasionally close schools in part because of high levels of absenteeism. Do you feel like there is a movement to try to improve the data, to make sense of the data that we have in terms of in-school transmission risk and how to abate it? Are you hearing of anything?
No, I don't think so. I think, you know, part of it is that's like really hard because it is an added burden for schools that they are just like not in a position to do. And I think this in some ways, this gets back to like, what do you want them to be spending their time on? Particularly since we now have a population of students who are like a year and a half behind in school, are like having a lot of socio-emotional and behavior problems. Like schools are just stretched to the absolute limit. And to be like, okay, also be a contact tracer is, you know, just like a lot. So I think if we want that to happen, there needs to be both a push and also not just help, like here's $43, just figure it out, but help, like, this is what you are doing. Here is the system. Here is how you enter the thing. You know, like we actually need to help people do this. And then there's like some interesting creative ways people could do it. Like, you know, these like, I don't know, there's like different interesting creative, like electronic solutions people could have, but we can't just tell schools like figure it out because they don't have the bandwidth for that.
So the Biden administration is, you know, celebrating the fact that they've given schools what they call a historic amount of money. It's $130 billion in the ARA that's supposed to go to make schools safer so that they can continue to remain open. I think there's also hope that in that will address some of the recovery issues that we're concerned about. Is there any effort that you've seen to kind of track what the impact of those funds have been, to understand how they've been used and to assess whether it's enough?
So the best data that I've seen tracking how this is used also comes from Dennis Roche at Verbio, who's been tracking how school districts are at least saying that they're going to spend this money. I haven't seen anybody kind of really, really sort of dive into tracking, at least in sort of outside of some larger districts or specific examples, kind of really trying to dive into how people are using this. I mean, I think it is quite important. And it's important, I think, both from a policy standpoint, but also it's important from like a learning standpoint. Like this district is going to take a lot of different approaches to how to do this recovery. They are facing a set of problems that are more extreme than we typically face, but are not like qualitatively completely different. So the idea of some students are behind, we need to help them catch up. That's something we experience even without the pandemic. And so, and there is an opportunity to kind of learn, you know, what kind of tutoring works well, what kind of extra supports work well, how, you know, how many behavioral health people do you need, stuff like that. It's going to take time to both do whatever kind of tracking needs to be done, and then to study, you know, to what extent does that work? Because a lot of those benefits are not going to show up like the next week.
So maybe kind of having you with your economist hat on, and just to kind of sketch out what we think the impact of this learning, the ultimate impact of this learning loss. I came across a report from McKinsey that found by the end of the 2021 school year, 2020-2021 school year, that students were, you know, an average of 4 to 5 months behind in reading and math, 4 and 5 months in reading and math respectively. The same thing that you talked about, the higher gaps in majority Black and low-income schools. And they ultimately then went on to estimate that if these gaps were not addressed, that it would result in lifetime learning losses between 49,000 and 61,000, which could, if it rolled up, sort of amount to 128 or between somewhere 128 and $188 billion in losses to the US economy. First of all, does that sound like a reasonable thing? Can you put those numbers into context for those of us who aren't economists?
Yeah, sure. So I think that there's a lot of effort to do this kind of thing. It's extremely, what we would say with my statistics hat on, it's extremely noisy. So I think what they are getting at is sort of something that is true, which is that when we have seen sort of disruptions in school or students fall behind, that can translate into being less likely to graduate from high school, being less likely to complete college, being less likely to, and those are going to translate into wage losses later. So I think I would imagine what they are doing is they're sort of taking the losses here, kind of pushing them forward based on what we know from other data and then multiplying them by some numbers. And if you kind of multiply by the right numbers, you get to something like 180 billion. Of course, every step along that path is subject to statistical noise. And so the sort of range of even taking the numbers that we have as given is going to be like enormously big, much larger than is stated in the ranges that are given. Now, in terms of like what would be, but I think the broad conclusion that this has the potential to have like long-term lifetime impacts for these kids, that's absolutely right. What is going to determine whether that happens or not is probably a lot of what we do in the next 5 years, right? So particularly for these early life disruptions, kids who are showing up at kindergarten, there's an article in the New York Times the other day, like kids are basically showing up at kindergarten, like not able to read. I mean, of course they always show up not able to read. They're showing up at kindergarten in a place with literacy, letter recognition, and so on, that's substantially lower than they were. Those are things that we can make up, like with the right kind of tutoring, the right kind of, intervention. I think we have the potential to make up some of those losses. And then that's going to make that $180 billion small number smaller. There are some losses that I think are going to be much harder to make up, which is like the students who were in high school who chose not to finish high school because they got a job during the pandemic. They don't want to go back. I think that's a place we're going to lose more or less indefinitely. Those kids are probably not going to come back later. So there is a kind of long-term thing. Is it 180 billion or 200 billion or 100 billion or 50 billion or 300 billion or what? I mean, that's just really, really difficult to say.
Yeah. I mean, I was struck. I don't see evidence yet of a plan for recovery, or at least in the COVID-19 plan, it was still focused on keeping schools open and then, referencing funds that have been made available. You already sort of said they need to more than perhaps just here's some money, go to it. I mean, do you think that it's going to take, that we need a national educational recovery plan to ensure that we are using whatever funds that we have available to put us on a path towards recovery, that perhaps we don't have enough money already allocated? I mean, what do you think it's going to take to address this problem, given that what you said in the next 5 years, are critical?
Yeah, I mean, I think, this is like a little bit beyond the stuff that I understand well. I mean, my sense from kind of like seeing a little bit from the outside is that the issue right now isn't so much the amount of money, but the it's hard to tell whether we have enough money because it's not clear to people how to use it, nor do they really have the resources. And I don't so much mean financial resources, but just like the attention resources to figure out what they need. And so I think what would be helpful in a national recovery plan is probably closer to like, here's how we recommend you spend your money. And here are some, you know, resources to get people here, right? So some of this is like every school needs many more behavioral health specialists. They just like the behavior issues, the socio-emotional issues that are facing these schools are like very significant. And so people need, well, how do I find that person? We need to like train more of those people. We can't find them. Also, the money runs out in 3 years. Am I going to have this person for 3 years? I'm not going to have them anymore. You know, I spent a bunch of time talking to like the School Nurses Association. People are like, well, we have more school nurses. That's great. But like, we only have money for 2 years. And then what are we going to do? So I think that like thinking a little bit holistically about the fact that this plan is not about like fixing, you know, a little bit more summer learning loss. And like, if only we just like have a little tutoring, it's going to be fine. Like, this is a long-term problem that needs like a focused effort recovery, but one that goes beyond, you know, here's a handout and goes to like, here's how, you know, here are some evidence-based information about how you can fix some of these problems or start moving forward on some of them.
Yeah, you mentioned school nurses, and you know, I was really struck by the county where I live was one of the first counties to really kind of get out in front in terms of tracing contacts of COVID-19 cases. They were able to do that because they put to work the school nurses who weren't working in the schools when the schools were closed. And that really helped them kind of get a leg up in a way that many other places weren't.
Yeah.
But once they went back to school, the level of contact tracing, I even saw that in my own children in terms of like when we would get calls from contact tracers based on, you know, things that happened in schools. You really saw sort of an erosion of it. So it seems to me that this like short-term planning is there's just a lot of stuff that we need people to be done in our communities that's not going to go away in 3 years.
Agreed.
Okay, I'm going to open it up for some questions. I see some hands are up. So Christina, I'm going to turn it over to you and then we'll start taking questions.
We will take our first question from Thomas Balicki.
Hi, thanks for the great talk. It's a pleasure to hear you on this topic. So I'm Tom Boyke. I direct the Global Health Program here at the Council. I'm curious to hear more about whether the way we make decisions has changed in schools, have changed at all over the course of the pandemic. So to be specific, we just experienced Omicron surge, some schools closed, not a lot. And I'm curious, you've talked about the data over the course of the pandemic, but I'm wondering, you know, leaving aside what the outcomes were, are the ways in which we're making that decision, those decisions at a school level improving? And is there any sign that those improvements will be marshaled in future waves or in future public health emergencies?
Yeah. So I unfortunately don't see a lot of evidence that the way we're making these decisions is improving. You know, it felt very much in the 2021 school year that at least initial reopening decisions were more or less exclusively driven by you know, Republican vote share. Like actually, you know, that's like, if you look at those maps on our website and you look at it on top of like a, you know, 2016 county vote share for Trump, lines up really, really closely. And so, you know, that felt like in some ways very politically driven for some reasons that I think made sense when you sort of looked at the politics. When we got into this sort of fall 2021 school year, there was a huge amount of push to open, and the debates became more about like what are the kind of precautions that we're going to put in place that are going to be important for sort of keeping cases down. The thing that was sort of frustrating there was still no effort for data collection, right? So it wasn't like, okay, now we're all going to open. We all agree we need to know what precautions work. So let's like make sure that we're collecting that data. So at least we're going to have like be like in a better position to make those decisions. And so that what that did was in January, it left us with this like in this sort of very odd. So first in January, I left this very odd space where some places were open, some places were, you know, were closed, you know, a few places closed, most places didn't close, even though there was actually like a lot more COVID in terms of infection, you know, infection rates than there had been basically any time in the pandemic, including among kids, just because of the variant. It still didn't feel in there like there was kind of that we had articulated a system for how we were going to open or whatever. Then we get into the spring and now we're sort of having an argument about masking and should we take off masking or not, which is again, not super driven by any, does not appear to be driven by any like substantial amount of data collection. And so I think in some ways the question is different, but the fact that we're in this data poor environment with no concrete system for making decisions or way to say, you know, there's an on, there's an off, that's a very, I think that's remained just like really very frustrating. I mean, I think we still don't really know like how important is ventilation, how important is masking, how, like, we don't know any, we don't really know this in any meaningful way. And that's like really crazy 2 years in, I think.
Yeah. Certainly, you know, not the magnitude and, I mean, getting back to the earlier conversation about, you know, where is transmission happening? It's really important to understand where should we be applying our measures and, yes. And what measures should we be applying? So, okay, we'll take the next question.
Next question will be coming from Daniel Gilmer.
Thank you. Yes, Daniel Gilmer here, term member at CFR. And thank you for your insightful opening comments and answers to questions up to this point. Really resonated with me as a parent of kids in grade school. So might there have been more or less impact for higher performing students in each cohort? Is there a chance that they were less or more affected, although they may still have passed standardized tests, et cetera? And second, could you also speak to any undocumented upside here? Have kids perhaps learned and upskilled in ways that standardized tests don't necessarily register? Or is that a bit of a glass half full, you know, look at this picture?
Yeah. All right. Those are great. So let me address the first one first, because it's easier, which is, you know, in this discussion of test scores, in our analysis of test scores, you know, our primary, I was sort of focusing on this, like just binary, like, do you pass or not? Like, are you proficient by whatever is the state standard? But for the most part, these states also report, you know, were you very proficient, is like advanced proficient or below proficient. And actually the movement is on the whole distribution. So states that had, so there's an increase in the number of students who are below proficient if you have virtual learning, and there is overall a large increase in the number of students who are below proficient, and that is larger in places with virtual learning. Similarly, there's a reduction in the students who are in the like advanced pass group. That's the sort of more high achieving group, and that reduction is larger in places with more virtual learning. So the sort of patterns appear across the distribution. Now, is it likely that better performing students were hurt less by this? I would say almost certainly true. And in fact, I think we recently saw some data, I think it's from Curriculum Associates, which is, it's sort of more focused on the kind of overall changes, and arguing that like the most important determinant of how much you lost over the pandemic period was where you were before. And so it's the sort of students that were doing worse before that lost more. And I think that's consistent with probably some combination of, it's easier to stay up on things if you are, you know, finding them relatively easy, and probably the correlations between some of those achievement measures and some family background that was potentially going to let your parents, you know, better scaffold your virtual learning. So I think there's kind of both of those pieces going on.
Yeah, so like a translation of the curve across all points, maybe a little less amongst the highest performers, but still less than ideal. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. Now on the second question of like, did people learn other things? You know, I think it is definitely true that measuring things with standardized tests is not the only metric. And in fact, in this particular case, it seems plausible that some of the decline was just a result of the fact that teachers focused less on this test in this year. That would be sort of true across the board because it had potentially lower stakes. So I think there's a piece of kind of that highlights like just the limitations of standardized testing. On the other hand, you know, it tells us something. I don't think we have a great way. We never have a great way to measure the other stuff that kids are learning. It's certainly the case that for some kids, actually, like the pandemic was was very good for their learning. Like there are certainly some kids who didn't, who, you know, for whom school is a struggle, and like it was good to be home. I don't think that's the consistent experience. And this is the kind of thing, you know, I think we'll see more about over time, both on the dimension of kind of, well, what about mental health? You know, we know that was negatively affected on average. Is that actually less negatively affected if you weren't in school? Maybe it's more negatively affected. So it's a bunch of stuff that I think we'll be able to figure out over time. Standardized tests are sort of just the easiest one at the beginning.
That's just probably
great. Question. Thank you.
Thanks.
Yeah, thank you.
The question in my mind, if just jump in before we go to the next question, which is, are states' standardized test data standardized? Meaning, can you sort of aggregate it sort of at the national level to get a sense of how poorly the nation may be faring?
Not really. I mean, these, you know, all of these, we sort of can run these separately by state. They're kind of all doing a different kind of test. They generally have kind of roughly have the same pass rates. I think in this next school year, there will be better like NAEP testing and sort of like more testing that will be consistent across the entire country. And so we'll be able to get a better sense, but most of those did not appear last year. There's some of them that did, but it's been hard to like extract the data from them.
Great. Thank you for letting me cut in there. Okay, we'll go to the next question.
Next question is coming from Emmanuel Dardcourt.
Hi, Emmanuel Dardcourt from Helen Keller International, where I'm the Chief Program Officer. Thank you very much. That's really nice to hear a kind of science-based and reality-based discussion of this. It feels very different from what you read or hear usually. I have a kind of two questions building in part on your answer to the last question, but you know, you're saying that in the past 2 years, most decisions and opinions don't seem to have been very kind of fact-based. Are you seeing, do you feel like you have a conduit from what you're learning and seeing to policy? And then a quick linked discussion to that is, so obviously while COVID's in the news and in a very important thing, it seems there's an even larger issue of educational inequality, which is not kind of newsworthy, but it's probably an even bigger thing. Do you see any appetite either for COVID or for the wider one to address these through measures? Because you've made a couple of very specific recommendations, but are you seeing a path to them being actually enacted?
Yeah, so I don't know. I never know how much impact one has on policy. And so I don't, you know, there have been times when I felt like, okay, like we said something and then later, you know, somebody did something different, but I'm not sure that I have like a great line into policy. I think, you know, some of the data that we've produced has been used in various times by policymakers, which is gratifying, I suppose. You know, in terms of the question about inequality, this is one that is on my mind all the time, because I think one of the big takeaways from the pandemic stuff for me was that it exacerbated or it laid bare some of the inequalities that were always there, but we maybe were not really talking about. And so this goes back to like, even, you know, the sort of fall of 2020, there was a lot of discussion about, okay, we're gonna open schools when they need to have good ventilation. And then, you know, we're in Pittsburgh and people are like, we're Philadelphia. And it's like, well, actually, you know, in these like, you know, lower income areas of Philadelphia, the school windows don't open. So, you know, it was such a great idea to open the windows, but actually we've put bars on the windows in these locations and we can't open them. And then, you know, sort of many things that came out like that, you know, there's no toilet seats. There's no, people can't wash their hands because there's no soap. And then sort of getting into like, okay, well, you know, actually there are pre-existing test score differences. You know, there's huge differences in test scores across school districts. And by the way, like those test scores are correlated with school opening. So it is precisely the kids who are already doing well and having, you know, higher test scores and better learning environments who also got to go to school in the school year. So there's just many things like that where the pandemic, yes, it made the problem worse, but it made it worse from a place that it was already very bad. And so in some ways there's a challenge for policy here, which is to say, okay, well, can we come back better? Can we say, this is okay, look, do we get it? Like this was horrible. And also it revealed a bunch of things we were doing before that were also extremely bad. can we use what we are learning about, you know, catching up to try to actually not just, you know, catch up to the place that we were before, since we have now recognized that that place was not great. And, you know, can we actually, you know, use it to generate a more equitable setup? I don't know if there's going to be policy appetite for that. You know, I think it's a little Pollyanna-ish to think that there is, but you know, I guess that's part of, I don't know, maybe it's like productive naivete.
Thank you very much.
So on the inequality line, there had been all of these sort of fears that, you know, the closures or just the pandemic, whatever, would result in a lack, you know, parents basically pulling their kids out of school, loss of enrollment, either parents shifting to, you know, teaching their kids at home, or parents with means being able to put their kids in private schools, and that would ultimately sort of erode the support for public schooling. Is that something to worry about? Do you think that's real? Have you seen any evidence of that, or do you think we're kind of rebounding?
So, you know, the best kind of concrete evidence from this has come from Thomas D's work, where they looked at enrollments in the fall of 2020, and they looked at, you know, how those had changed in general, and also how they changed with differences in schooling load. And what they found was, you know, there were some small reductions in enrollments as a result of, you know, in like there was sort of some small reductions associated with having a virtual learning environment, but they were like 1%. Right. So they were not, and just smaller reductions in general. And they were basically concentrated in the in kindergarten. So I think one of the things that is probably true, and something that we are going to see, that we've already started to see this school year, is that a bunch of people didn't have their kids go to kindergarten. And in some places, that means they are going to kindergarten a year late. And in many places, it means they're going straight to first grade, right? Because there's a bunch of places in the US where kindergarten is not necessary. Like, not required. And so kids basically just like didn't go to kindergarten and instead went to first grade. And I think that's some of what we're seeing in these like literacy, kind of lower literacy skills that you would have learned something in kindergarten. You know, we're gonna see the impacts of that in, I don't know, potentially later. In terms of like the sort of systematic, like, is everyone abandoning the public school system? I think that that's a little over. My sense is that's a little overblown, that like we haven't actually seen quite that level of like wholesale departure from the normal schooling system. Clearly, this was a disruptive, and the amount of homeschooling has got up a lot, and pod schooling and this, you know, but on the whole, changes like that, they're going to be small because, you know, the public school systems basically works pretty well. And that's kind of what people are going to stick with.
So we've been mostly talking about sort of K-12 school, but maybe just to go a little bit earlier, I feel like there was a time maybe 10 years ago where there was a lot of policy conversation about the importance of preschool, yeah, and having kids in a preschool environment, and, you know, studies showing that kids who didn't go to preschool were, you know, going to suffer immensely, and, you know, really a strong push for universal pre-K and others. Are you seeing any evidence or effort to track sort of what the pandemic related disruptions to preschool education will mean for kids? And
so the preschool discussion in the last couple of years has been super, super interesting. So one piece of it has been like the sort of disruptive preschool for this pandemic cohort. And there, honestly, most of the discussion is focused around like how disruptive this is for parents. And so a lot of like, even in this last, you know, sort of period, and I think January, like sort of December, January was kind of a low for many people, where really, even though K-12 schools were basically back and operating pretty normally, like daycare centers, you know, childcare centers were just not. And so parents were just like, you know, I'm paying for this like very expensive pre-K or preschool or whatever. And you know, my kid's gone for like 3 days between December 1st and January 24th. Like they've only had 3 days of schooling. And like, this is, so there's, I think a lot of the discussion there was just around the disruptions to parents. And of course those disruptions, I think, have pushed people like out of organized childcare settings into like something that they can make work, like you know, grandparents or stay-at-home parents or whatever it is. So I think that's been, you know, that's been kind of the big disruption there. The other thing that's happened that's very interesting that I'm still sort of like processing, I think many people are still processing, is we got at least one new study, like quite good new study out of Duke, I want to say, about preschool, which sort of questioned the kind of like positive impacts of some of these pre-K programs. So I think there's been like a lot of, I think there are some issues with that study, and a lot of these sort of pre-K benefits probably accrue like weirdly quite late, like in, you know, high school graduation. But I think it's sort of made many of us kind of step back and think, and, you know, sort of try to understand the landscape of what is the evidence on pre-K and, you know, how should that be structured, and how, you know, how should we think about that kind of, how should we think about that kind of, or that setting?
But your earlier points, I think we referenced the New York Times article, and I think there was, you know, talking about, you know, the kindergartner showing up and sort of not having that same foundation that they sort of used to or were sort of expected to. I've certainly seen the difference in starting kindergarten between my two children, which maybe is just personality, but also felt a little bit like different levels of preparation. And I'm just sort of wondering if there has been an effort, or, you know, if we can see that sort of in the kindergartner cohort.
Yeah, I think we'll see. You know, I think we will see more work on that over the next, you know, few years. I mean, if you look at what kind of what is gained in terms of these, like, I mean, this gets back to, like, I think Daniel's question about the test scores. Like, if you look at kind of what do we see in the data about the benefits of like pre-K, it kind of shows up in kindergarten test scores and then in like adult outcomes. So it's kind of like, it's like there's a sort of very odd aspect of some of these data. You can see in like the Boston pre-K study where like the kids who go to pre-K, they're good at taking tests in kindergarten, and then they're more likely to graduate from high school, but they don't appear to be like better at taking tests in the fifth grade or better at taking tests in the third grade. And so there's this sort of like very odd thing. I think people are kind of still trying to wrap their heads around about like what is being conveyed by that. But in terms of these like literacy skills, the extent to which those are developed in pre-K, those benefits seem to kind of like diminish pretty quickly. So I think we might imagine that, you know, we would see this year's kindergarten class do more poorly in whatever test we give them at the end of the year. That seems extremely likely. Will they still be doing more poorly at the end of first grade or the end of second grade? I am less sure. Will we then see that effect, you know, whatever is the other thing that's going on, like, you know, out in high school, that, you know, that's also, I think that, you know, again, like remains to be seen. Yeah.
That's interesting. What's next? What's next for your pandemic, the COVID data hub? Do you have any new directions that you want to put into?
Yeah. I mean, I think that for us, kind of the next big thing is to try to sort of look at some of the health impacts in a more for kids in a more detailed way. So we have a bunch of basically like claims data, EMR data, which we can merge in with this and try to look at, you know, ER visits for eating disorders, ER visits for self-harm, and sort of think about the extent to which those are just generally sort of changing during the pandemic, but also, you know, the extent to which they overlap with schooling mode. I think what's interesting there is, you know, has a potential to reveal a bunch of things about the kind of benefits of school. So take something like ADHD, which, you know, is like often diagnosed in school. And so not having access to school is likely to change the incidence of that, purely based on sort of like the fact that diagnoses are moved later. So thinking about what are the impacts of that. So that's kind of the next thing for us. Mm. We had another question. Do we have time to take Beverly's question?
Oh yeah, sorry, Beverly, I didn't see your hand up. Great. Go ahead, Beverly.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
I'm going to put on my hat from my former position when I was the academic dean at the College of Education at the University of Georgia.
Excellent.
And the University of Georgia and Texas A&M have the largest colleges of education and the most comprehensive ones in the United States. There were a number of factors, Emily, that you mentioned that are really, really important. But the first point I would say is, did you not simply have data from places like Pennsylvania and Montana? When I was looking, they just simply didn't provide it, or it wasn't accessible?
So the answer to that differs. In Montana, we are working on it. They say that we're in their queue. I don't know what that means. I think they do have it. In Pennsylvania has proved to be, Beverly, I have to tell you, the most difficult state. So if you know anybody in the Pennsylvania state government, they told us they didn't ever collect the data. Then later they told us maybe they did. Then they tried to. So we just, like, some of these places, no matter how many people we call, they just won't call us back.
Well, actually, I was a dean at Penn State as well. So I actually have.
Some All right. I mean, you gotta send me an email. We're going to, like, Beverly, we work this out. I need that filled in.
I'm not necessarily going to call them, but I was very curious. I may ask them on a personal level, why isn't this out there? Yeah. But of course, you know very well at the federal level with the Institute of Education Science and similar places, that data in general is 2 to 3 years behind. I mean, yeah. That's just because when they collect it. But what I was unclear about in several instances, is this aggregate data for the entire K-12 in certain school systems? Or because, for example, if you start looking at some schools refer to it as elementary school, some schools say middle school, some schools say high school, and even in elementary, there can be K through grade 4, and then grade 4 through grade 8 or 9. I was very curious as to how this data is broken down. That was one question, but the other very, very significant question that's an issue I know in Georgia and in Texas, and that is with the qualifications of the teachers. Because it varies widely. There are counties in Texas where people don't want to go. So you can end up being a teacher after 3 years and without a degree, and you're working on a degree. It doesn't happen as much in Georgia, at least according to my colleagues, but I would suspect that is an effect. I would also point out that there is a difference between people who are teachers through programs such as Teach for America. And yes, they're teaching and they're probably providing options that would not otherwise be available, but they're not the same as our students from Penn State or from the University of Georgia or Georgia State who graduate really with 5 years of training. And they've been taught, we hope, in our colleges of education to prepare for some of these kinds of options. And what really struck me is when you were talking about, and you did percentage differences in decline. And I don't know if those are actually statistically significant, for example, between certain socioeconomic or demographic groups, because even if you take whole demographics constant, there is certainly a difference between, let's say, Latinas. And in Georgia, there's many more Latin American people of Latin background than even 15 years ago. So if you were to look at those students, and they're concentrated in certain areas like Conyers versus other areas. So those were the kinds of questions. And I know you probably didn't have a chance to get into all of that, but those of us who've been in colleges of education, I'm in a social science college now, but they're such meaty questions that we look at in our analysis and in our research to try to modify our programs.
Okay. So let me just, because we have 2 minutes and you are right, these are incredibly meaty questions. Let me just say two things. So one is on this question of, like, what are the age groups and so on. In the overall data, we collect data. It's uniform for K-12. And sometimes we have it by school. Sometimes we have it by grade band and district. Sometimes we have it by district. And so that's kind of the source of the data. When we move to the test scores, we analyze math and ELA for grades 3 through 8. And so in all of the states and sort of all of the settings, that's kind of the group that we're focused on. And we merge in with the learning modes associated with those grades. And just the last thing I will say is I like your idea about the teacher quality quite a lot. That's actually something that we could, not quality, but teacher training. That's actually something we could think about trying to cross into our data just to look at some of those impacts. And I appreciate all the rest of that. You are absolutely right that the issues here, there's, like, just so much that we can only a little bit scratch the surface.
So big issues, a lot of work to be done, but very grateful to you for, you know, really spearheading a lot of this, you know, and first of all, coming to share your insights with us, but also just, you know, continuing to weigh in and trying to analyze these data. I know many, many, many parents come to you for data-driven advice, but I'm very grateful that you included in your attention these pandemic-related issues and are helping us improve our understanding. So thank you so much
for your time
today and for sharing.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you for coming.